The following program may contain coarse language, violence, nudity, mature subject matter, or scenes which may not be suitable for all viewers. Viewer discretion is advised.
This is the Exxon Broadcast Network, broadcasting worldwide on broadcast affiliates and satellite program providers, including CNN Broadcast Network, Sirius Satellite Network, Star Media, Good News Radio Network, Angel Broadcast Network, Wiki Broadcast Network, and WPBN-TV. For more information on the X-Zone Broadcast Network, visit us at www.xzbn.net.
All Hit Radio.
Welcome to the X-Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Welcome to the X-Zone, everyone. My name is Rob McConnell. We're coming to you from our broadcast center in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. If you'd like to give us a call, 800-610-7035 is worldwide toll-free. Our email, xzone@xzoneradiotv.com, on all social media sites, xzoneradiotv. And our site, our website, that I am told is going to be revamped, revitalized, and renewed. Sounds like something you'd hear on the shopping channel. Anyway, it's www.xzoneradiotv.com. My guest this hour is Lieutenant Colonel Bill Cowan from the United States Marine Corps. He is now retired, and he's a highly decorated retired U.S. Marine Corps officer and a commentator since 2002 on terrorism and national security for the Fox News Channel, and he is also the co-host of his own radio show that airs Saturdays in Washington, D.C., and can be heard worldwide. We're going to let you find out about how you can listen to Bill and his show Danger Zone later on. 1966 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy, Colonel Cowan served 3.5 years on combat assignments in Vietnam as an infantry officer. He was a platoon commander along the DMZ during the fall of 1967 and also served as a platoon commander during the siege of Khe Sanh. He spent 2.5 years as an advisor in the Rung Sat Special Zone, that's just south of Saigon, decorated many times for heroism. He also received 3 Purple Hearts for wounds received. Now, following the taking of the U.S. hostages in Iran in 1978, Colonel Cowan turned down a prestigious White House assignment to instead become the only and first Marine in the Pentagon's most classified counter-terrorist unit. While there, he conducted numerous clandestine and covert operations in the Middle East and Latin America. Notably, he was a key member of the team that went into Lebanon to hunt down those responsible for the bombing of the Marine compound in 1983. Now, working directly with CIA Chief of Station Chief William Buckley, Colonel Cowan and his team developed a plan for retaliation and identified many of the targets. Regrettably, the Pentagon refused to take action. For more information on Colonel Cowan, www.colonelcowan.com. And Colonel Cowan, welcome to the X-Zone, sir.
Thanks for inviting me, Rob. It's a privilege to be with you.
Colonel, you've seen it all. I've gone through your bio. You have one distinguished career, sir, and I like to say this to members of the military when I have the opportunity of getting them on. Thank you for everything that you and the men and women in the armed forces around the world have done for us to make sure that democracy and freedom is maintained. So thank you.
Well, thanks, Rob. I think in my own case, and certainly that of most of my colleagues who serve, we all consider it a privilege to be able to serve our country and serve your country, to serve people, to try to do the right thing. So it's a privilege, and I appreciate you saying thank you.
Colonel, what is going on in the world today? It seems that we're going to hell in a handbasket.
Unbelievable. And the problem is there's so many places to look and find things that are going on. You and I will have a wonderful interview tonight, and the whole topic of China probably won't even need to come up. But, you know, your listeners who are following the news know that we have major issues over there in China right now with the way they're operating in their own sphere of influence. But clearly, China doesn't threaten us at this point, Rob. It is all about ISIS. Here we were on the verge of having most of our troops home, mm-hmm. having our fighting pretty much done in Iraq, certainly about to end up in Afghanistan. We couldn't categorize either one of them necessarily as victories, but we were about to have our troops home. And now this ISIS thing jumps up, and it's certainly a bigger threat than either Iraq or Afghanistan posed to us, and it's clearly something we're going to have to deal with.
But, Colonel, surely the intelligence community has been feeding the information to the decision-makers in Washington that this was an ongoing threat, it was an ongoing problem, and yet, to those of us on the outside, it seems like there was no planning just in case something did happen.
I think that's the fact there was no planning might be the impression the White House would like to leave out there, because the president certainly said we had no strategy yet. Mm-hmm. I tend to believe the people inside the Pentagon who say quietly, and some of them may come a little bit more public, saying that we really were providing the White House all the information that they needed in order to identify the threat that we were facing, in order to watch it grow, mm-hmm. and in order to prepare the American public. And, of course, none of those things were done. It's okay to have watched ISIS grow, perhaps, and not do anything about it until they crossed the border into Iraq and swooped down through towns. But I think on some level we really wanted the American public, it's really incumbent upon leadership, to be making sure that the American public, and the Canadian public, excuse me, Rob, I don't mean to be so self-serving.
But you're not, sir.
That both of our publics understand what's going on, and our White House certainly didn't do any of that. And if they knew a lot about what was happening and didn't talk about it, it goes back to the whole idea, as the president had said, that ISIS was a JV team and Al-Qaeda was on the run. And, of course, neither one of those things are necessarily true.
Stand by, Colonel. We've got to take a two-minute break. ExoNation, Colonel Bill Cowan is my special guest. www.colonelcowan.com. Modern Esoteric, Beyond Our Senses by Brad Olson, consummates the lifeology story about where humanity originates. It is the lost continents, the primitive wisdom, the mythos of creation, and the rethinking of ancient history as we are taught in academia. There is much more to the story than what we have been told. As this is the first book in the Esoteric series, Modern Esoteric starts at the beginning of time and accelerates up to this modern age. Future Esoteric is book two in the series and takes a forward-looking position ahead of today with an open and honest examination of the ET issue and various unexplained phenomena. To discover the writings of author Brad Olson, visit www.bradolson.com. That's www.bradolson.com. Named one of the world's greatest psychics, Elizabeth Joyce is now giving readings worldwide via Skype. Elizabeth Joyce is recognized for her clairvoyant ability to help find missing persons, her analysis of dreams, past life regression work, mediumship, and her accurate predictions. Elizabeth has been a frequent guest on the X-Zone radio show with yours truly, Rob McConnell, now for several years. For an appointment with Elizabeth Joyce, call 201-934-8986 or Skype at elizabeth.joyce. And for more information, you can always visit Elizabeth Joyce online at www.new-visions.com. ExoNation, our guest this hour is Lieutenant Colonel Bill Cowan. He's retired now from the United States Marine Corps. His website is www.colonelcowan.com. That's C-O-L-O-N-E-L, Cowan.com. Colonel, what do we know about ISIS? What is the story behind the story? It seems that the first time we heard about ISIS in the mainstream media is not that long ago, but has ISIS been on the radar of the defense as well as the intelligence community long before now?
Well, I'm going to tell you something interesting that I don't think I've said before on the media, but I have some pretty good knowledge of. When the U.S. forces, when our ground troops were still working inside Iraq up till the end of December of 2011, Rob, our intelligence guys were probably as finely tuned as the U.S. military intelligence has ever been. They were running in-depth clandestine operations. And they had really gotten to the point where they had a good handle on everything. In fact, you know, we ran many wonderful operations against the insurgents, Bin Laden type operations where we ran these operations at nighttime, and it was all on the basis of really good intelligence. Unfortunately, when we pulled of our people out in 2011, we pulled all those intelligence people out also, and for the most part, all those intelligence operations were shut down. The CIA decided at the same time, well, since we don't have the military here anymore to help provide security, we're going to cut down our operations also. So we had a couple-year void there about what was really going on. We certainly had minimal, at best, intelligence operations inside Syria, Rob. So we've had quite a period of time there where our eyes on target, about the best we could do was whatever signals intelligence we could capture and whatever imagery we could capture. And during that period of time, we certainly knew who the key players were in ISIS. Some of them were, but we weren't able to keep an eye on them. And ISIS really had the ability to grow exponentially inside of Syria and then, of course, make their way over into Iraq earlier this year. And my hope is at this point that we're going back somehow and trying to reinitiate. A lot of those on-the-ground assets were Sunnis. They came out of the tribes that helped us during the surge. And, of course, ISIS and all the people following it are Sunnis also, for the most part, 99% are also Sunnis. So the tribes over there, the ISIS is impacting on tribes, and many of them have fallen in with ISIS, probably out of fear. Others have been standing a little bit standoffish and not quite jumped aboard yet, and hopefully we have the ability to go back and reinitiate a lot of those old contacts we had and try to get something working again, which will provide us the kinds of intelligence we need to fight an.
Now, President Obama and the Prime Minister of Canada, Prime Minister Harper, and the rest of the NATO member countries' heads are in Wales, and they're trying to, I understand, put together a fast or swift response team that would be able to get a number of troops to a member country within 48 hours. As a member of the military, a commander with several years' experience, will this work?
Well, listen, I actually did a Fox television hit and talked briefly about that today. The International Rapid Response Force, my goodness, can you imagine how long it's going to take to put something like that together?
Yeah.
To decide what the chains of command are going to be, what the rules of engagement are going to be. Frankly, in Afghanistan, you know, we have the ISAF, the International Security Assistance Force. NATO's a player over there, and all of our various countries have essentially been fighting under different rules of engagement. So when you talk about the complexity of trying to put some international rapid response force together, the rhetoric sounds great. It all sounds wonderful. But the application and the organization and the time it's going to take to do it tells me that we're a couple years away from having one that's truly effective, maybe 3 to 6 months away from having something that essentially looks like it's going to do good and can go in and do some things, but it's going to take a long time before we have an effective force that can really do much. And a lot of the talk about that international force also deals with Putin and with Russia and the Ukraine right now, and I'm sure Vladimir Putin's looking at this and kind of snickering and laughing and saying, yeah, I'll believe it when I see it. So. It's a great idea, and it sounds good on paper, and maybe it'll work, but I think it's going to be much more complex, much more difficult than it sounds right out of the gates.
The way I see it is, here you've got a number of nations trying to use diplomacy, where I don't think diplomacy is the answer right now.
I keep waiting for President Obama to figure out how he's going to use sanctions on ISIL. You know, we're going to use. Yeah, I don't think it's going to work either. Not that they don't have. You know, they've got some pretty heavy-handed economic activity going on. $2 million a day in oil revenues that they're selling on the black market. There are certainly things that could be done to undermine their ability